As we prepare our hearts for worship, I want to read from Micah chapter 4. It shall come to pass in those latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and it shall be lifted up above the hills, and people shall flow to it, and many nations shall come, and shall say, Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Israel, of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Let's pray. Our great God, we come to you this evening and we urge, we desire, we long, we ask that you would pour out upon us a blessing. We are helpless and hopeless in our own strength. Trusting in our own arm, we inevitably fall and fail. But we come to you. You are our rock. In the midst of all the turbulent seas of our human experience, and the rise and fall of our emotions, in the success and failure of our lives, when all else and all others desert us, we find ourselves returning over and over again to you. You, O Lord, are our rock, our steadfast portion, our God in whom we trust. And though our faith is weak, though our trust is slender, it is in whom we trust that our great strength lies. And so we come to you this evening. We come to you for you. You it is we want. You it is we desire. You it is that we worship and love and adore as we come in Jesus' name by the Spirit. Amen.
Please remain standing as together we come before our great God with a prayer of confession, one that is found in your bulletin. Gracious God, we confess that we honor you in our hearts, words, and deeds. Depending on our strength, we stumble. Glorying in our own righteousness, we reject you. Turning our faces from you, we desire the things of this world to satisfy us. We pray now, Lord, for you to forgive all our many sins, to cleanse the darkness from our lives, and turn our faces and our hearts back to you. We pray these things in the name of your most precious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. The gospel is most wonderful and assures us of our salvation and pardon from sin. We see Paul writes in Romans chapter 5, 1 and 2, "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God." Please be seated. Do turn in your Bibles to Song of Songs, chapter 6. We're going to read together this evening, from verse 1 through 3. You can find this in the Bible in the rack in front of you on page 563. That's between the book of Ecclesiastes as well as Isaiah. Before we hear God's word read and preached, let's first turn to our great God in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for this Lord's Day, a day when we remember again Jesus Christ, risen from the dead. We have gathered this evening, reminded afresh that you are at the center of all things. You are at the center of our worship, and it is from you that we long to hear this evening. As your word is preached, it is neither the opinions nor platitudes of men that our souls hunger for or most basically need. But Lord, we long to hear your voice, the voice of our matchless God. Your word is true. It brings comfort and correction, wisdom and insight, and with grace in the power of the Holy Spirit. And as the psalmist pronounces, "How sweet are the words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth." Feed us, O God, from your mouth this evening. Still our anxious hearts with your word. Convict us of sin that we might be free. Conform us to the image of your Son, who is most beautiful, and restore us where the devourer has come and stolen. And may that which you treasure and prized most supreme be the treasure of our hearts. We ask these things in the magnificent name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Song of Songs, chapter 6, verse 1 through 3. Where has your beloved gone, O most beautiful among women? Where has your beloved turned, that we may seek him with you? My beloved has gone down to his garden, to the beds of spices, to graze in the gardens and to gather lilies. I am my beloved's, and my beloved's is mine. He grazes among the lilies. This is God's word. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you are good, that you know all things, that you love your people, and that you provide for us. We ask this evening, as we bring our tithes and offerings in worship of you, that you would use these for the good of your kingdom, for the extension of your kingdom, both here as well as around the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
And turn together to Song of Solomon. We're going to be pausing this. Next Sunday night, I want to move into a couple of studies on the subject of getting the gospel out. And this is a transitional one this evening. Very conveniently transitional. For those of you who have not been here before, the Song of Solomon has become, in evangelicalism, certainly for the last 50 years, a book about sex or marriage. Historically, however, the Song of Solomon for the Jews and for Christians for 2,000 years has been a book about the people of God and God, Yahweh's wife, Israel, Christ's bride, the church. And so we're going countercultural in our approach to the Song of Solomon. It's in the Bible, which means it's a theological book. That is, it's a book about God. There are all things outside of the Bible that are good and given to us by natural revelation and by common sense as a result of God's general providence. And we can learn lots of stuff from outside about the subjects that I just mentioned. The Bible is a book about God. And so, as we get to this little section that I'm going to be looking at with you this evening, that has to be on our minds. In fact, it's the second of two questions or approaches that have been made to the bride, that is, to the church or to Israel, the people of God. There's a question in verse 9 of chapter 5, and then a question in verse 1 of chapter 6. These questions are asked by others, unnamed people. We don't know who they are. Some of the rabbis thought that these others were Gentiles, coming to Jews and asking Jews where they could find God in after the manner of Isaiah. You remember in Isaiah 2 where the nations will come and they'll grab the robe of one Jew and say, "Show us your God, teach us the way of your God." The first question is actually in the tone of a taunt. We looked at that last time. She's being questioned, the church is being questioned, about why it is that she believes what she believes. What is your beloved? What is your God more than our God? Your beloved more than any other beloved? That's the question. What makes him separate, different? And her response that we looked at last time from verse 10 and onwards, her response is to describe him to them. They're mocking her. They're taunting her. But she calmly and without retaliation describes her beloved. We know her beloved as the one that was identified by the Father. "This is my beloved son." So she describes him. We looked at this last time, and if you read verses 10 to the end, you will discover something. It is obvious that the bride has not yet seen him, literally seen him. What she describes has a general, we might say, human appearance. But when you read it, it sounds more like she's describing some monument. There's a kind of blend of the physical appearance of a head and a body and arms and legs and so on. But as she describes it, you discover that she's describing things that are material. In other words, there's a combination of the physical and the material imagery. It's obvious that she's never seen him. What she's describing, she knows notionally, intellectually. She's describing one who has a human appearance and a monumental appearance. His radiant face reminds us of the descriptions that you find over and over again in the Bible whenever God appears to people. The sun is the radiance of the glory of God. His face shines like the brightness of the sun, we're told in Revelation 1, for example. And elsewhere, whenever there's a revelation of God, radiance is the key. Whereas in verse 10, his ruddy appearance, as we looked at last time, has a human quality to it. In other words, from our New Testament perspective, as we go back to read this, we're thinking of one who is both the radiance of the glory of God and yet who is human, who has joined in himself deity and humanity in one. She's describing the God-man. Because mere humans don't have heads of solid gold or legs like solid gold. I mean, you think about it for a moment. These categories that she uses in their description, lilies do not normally drip myrrh. Human heads and hands are not usually made of solid gold. Bodies the physical core of the body that's described. Bodies are not usually made of solid ivory. Legs are never made of marble set in sockets of gold. In other words, she's describing not someone she's encountered physically. She's describing the way that those who've had a vision of God describe God. Look at Ezekiel chapter 1, for example, and some of the descriptions in the book of Revelation, for example, in which the descriptions of God use this kind of imagery, this kind of language, because you're describing what is indescribable. You're describing what is incomprehensible. It's beyond our ability to comprehend. When the Apostle John is describing Jesus in Revelation 1, even though he has known Jesus according to the flesh, he does not describe Jesus in his physical appearance. He describes Jesus with this kind of language because he's describing Jesus glorified. He's describing Jesus as he is now, radiant with the glory of God, just as he saw when he saw Jesus transfigured on the Mount of Transfiguration. And the other thing is that there are elements that are used in this book that explain symbolism that we discover very, very early on in the New Testament story. We begin our New Testament in Matthew's Gospel, and very shortly after the beginning, you have these wise men from the east to come to worship him. And they come bringing what? They come bringing gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And when people are treating that, when New Testament scholars are treating these things, they never really come to a conclusion as to why those elements are used. I mean, myrrh, well, that was used for burial. Frankincense was often used in the temple and so on. But where in the Bible are those elements used the most to describe God? The answer is in the Song of Solomon. There you will find them in abundance. This Song of Songs. And it seems as if that incidental New Testament insight is meant to help you understand this most intimate of books, describing the relationship that exists between Christ and his church, whom he loves. It's providing us with categories of thought. But tonight we come to this other question. Here's where I want to stand and stop and bed down for the evening, if I can use that expression. Now the tone has changed from taunt. The tone has changed in chapter 6, verse 1, to a question. There is a different tone now. This is now more like the description you have in Isaiah chapter 2 of the Gentiles, those who are mocking Israel for their belief in one God as opposed to the many other gods that they worship. Here it seems these Gentiles are now wondering whether they'd like to meet Israel's God. Where has your beloved gone, O most beautiful among women? Well, they're being nice to her now. Where has your beloved gone that we may seek him with you? That we may seek him. You see the change of tone? No longer mockery. No longer are these people trying to make her embarrassed. Now they're really interested in finding out, where is he? Where has he gone? And her answer is very important because it's the same answer that you and I would want to give to people who ask us that question today. Where has he gone? Well, my beloved has gone down to his garden, to the beds of spices, to graze in the garden and to gather lilies.
Well, you see, I'm not really going to say that tomorrow morning when somebody comes to me and says, you know, I'm really interested in Jesus. Where am I going to find him? These aren't the words I'm going to choose. Well, of course, they're not the words you're going to choose. But if you've been studying along with us in Song of Solomon, you'll know that earlier on we discovered that the garden is a metaphor. It's an echo of Eden. Eden in the Bible is the first temple. Eden in the Bible is the first place where God comes down in the cool of the day to meet with his people. The same language is used when they build the tabernacle and they decorate the tabernacle with ferns and trees and flowers to remind them of the Garden of Eden. Whenever they go to God comes down to the tabernacle to meet with his people, to walk with his people, is the language that he uses. And then when they build the temple, they decorate the temple to remind them of a garden, to remind them of Eden. And God says again about the temple, I will come down and I'll walk with you. And I'll have fellowship with you. And then in the New Testament, Jesus builds his church, creates his church. His church is the new Eden. It's the new temple. It's the place where God comes and meets with his people. He is present with his people. So this image of the garden in the Song of Solomon, this image of the garden in the whole biblical context that's going to end at the end of all things in the new heavens and the new earth, where the final temple is when God comes to be with his people and his bride comes down from heaven, adorned for her husband, and the new Jerusalem, the new Zion, is a garden city in which God dwells forever with his people. In other words, to put it in our language, where is Jesus to be found? He's to be found among his people. He's to be found among his people, found in his church, among his own. That's where he's to be found. Somebody says, how can I learn about Jesus? Where do you point them? You point them to the church. Because as Augustine said, outside the church there's no salvation. There's no news of salvation. There's no possibility of hearing about salvation outside of the church. That's why there is a church in the world. That's why there are people who call on the name of the Lord, as we do Sunday by Sunday. There is a place where people can find Jesus among his people, in his church. My beloved has gone down to his garden to gather lilies. We looked at this. The lily is the very word Jesus says to his people, the one he loves, earlier on in the book of Song of Songs, where he comes to and he names them. He names his people lilies. He gathers the lilies. He comes down and he is among the lilies. He's among his people. They're white. He gives them white robes, as it were, because he set them apart for himself, and he is with them and among them, and he cares for them, and he loves them, and they're his. Where's Jesus to be found? He's to be found in his church. That's what you would say to someone. Where can I learn about your beloved? Well, you learn about our beloved when you meet with his people, when you're among the lilies, where he is. That's where he's to be found. I know where Jesus is. Every Sunday, I know exactly where to find Jesus. He's here. He's here when we gather to worship. He's here amongst us by his Spirit. But Jesus is to be found not only among his people in the church. He is to be found on the lips of his people. On the lips of his people who confess his name. Do you see that? In verses 2 and 3, where is he to be found? Well, he's to be found in his garden, in his church. But she doesn't stop there. The church doesn't stop there. The church cannot stop without confessing her Lord. My beloved, I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. Now, this expression, it's important to notice, is the personalization of the covenant promises that God has made to Israel and that God has made to us, the church, today. You know the fundamental promise that God made way back in Genesis 17 was this: I will be your God, you will be my people. I will be your God, you will be my people. In Exodus 6, I will take you to be my people, and I will be your God, and you shall know that I am the Lord, your God. Your God. And the Apostle Paul picks up that very language when he's writing to the church in Corinth. And it wasn't even a very holy church. It wasn't the best church to go to. I would reckon if you went to a Christian conference in the first century and they asked you what church you went to, you would have said, where was that? Corinth. And they would say, you didn't say Corinth, did you? Did I say Corinth? I mean, Corinth was not a wonderful church, but it was a church. And here's what Paul writes to Corinth. For we, plural, we the church, are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Paul is there actually echoing this very verse. Where is to be found? He's to be found in his church, among his people. Paul says, we, plural, the body of the church, are the temple of the living God. God says to us, I will make my dwelling among them, walk among them. I will be their God. They will be my people. Now, you see now, when you read these words, this is a personalization of these covenant promises. I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. And you can tease that out to your heart's content, really. In what sense am I my beloved's? Well, he made me by creation. He made me. He made the church. He created the church. The church was created by God. And the church belongs to God by his own creation, his act of will. We are his by redemption. He's redeemed us. We've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. We've been found in our sin and in our rebellion, and Christ has died for us, and Christ, by his death and resurrection, has bought us back for God. By adoption, the church has been adopted into the family of God. We've been made children of God, sons and daughters of God, heirs to the promises. All of this God has done for us. I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. My beloved is mine. Personal possession, he is mine. He loves me. He is my beloved. He came from heaven and sought me to be his holy bride, and with his blood he bought me, and for my life he died. That's what the church can say. It's a love story. Christ loved the church, gave himself for it. He is the great husband of the church. He did all this for his people. And the church must confess this to the world. We can't keep silent about this to the world. This is our statement. I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. And I say that this is the most fundamental element. Here is, if you like, it seems to me, evangelism in the bud. It comes down to this. This is what we say to people who may be seeking God. And I think it emphasizes the fact that one of the things the church exists for, apart from our primary purpose, and that is to have communion with God, is that we exist to draw others in to the garden. That's what she's saying to them. You know, the church is saying to the world, Israel is saying to the nations, he grazes among the lilies. You want to find him? You find him among his people. It's an invitation to come. It's an invitation to join. So when we fast forward then to the book of Acts, and when in the book of Acts we watch the early church beginning to move and grow, this is exactly the kind of thing that we find. You find the apostles, for example, who are quite unique in their office. They're quite transitional. Their role was to continue Jesus' work. And so you find all around their work elements that you only find Jesus doing. So Ananias and Sapphira, for example, have a dramatic death. Tabitha is raised from the dead. Prison doors are opened by an angel. Prison chains are unfastened by an earthquake. Handkerchiefs and aprons touch Paul's body and people are healed. Peter's shadow landing on someone heals the sick. Peter and Paul have visions. They see Christ. They're blinded by the light of heaven. They hear him speak to them in Hebrew. Miracles happen because they have been with Jesus. Quite unique. They have been with Jesus. But the apostles are the ones who begin this great campaign to spread the news of Jesus to the world. Right from the very beginning, in chapter 6, for example, of Acts, they say this: we shouldn't give up preaching the word of God. They were being distracted, and they have to make this resolution. We will not give up preaching the word of God. It is a word. It is an utterance. It is a confession. The whole business of conversion is that people hear and receive that word that is spoken to them. So on the first missionary journey, Paul and Barnabas proclaimed the word of God at Salamis and in Cyprus. They spoke the word of God in Antioch. Paul taught in Corinth. The word of God, or the word of the Lord, was preached among the Thessalonians. People received it, not as the word of man, but as the word of God, which it truly is. Those who heard it, like these others in this passage, heard the word of God and received the word of God. People gave heed to it. Lydia heard it. The Lord opened her heart to give heed to what was said by Paul. When the church starts to grow, this is how it's described. There is an increase, a spread, a multiplication, a prevailing of the word of God. This very word, this testimony to Jesus. And people, they spent invested time in this business of getting the good news of the gospel out. In Iconium, we were for a long time there, boldly speaking for the Lord. In Philippi, they remained in the city for some days. Lydia had her heart opened. In Thessalonica, Paul reasoned in the synagogue for 3 weeks. In Corinth, he argued in the synagogue every Sabbath. He stayed a year and 6 months teaching the word of God among them. In Ephesians, Paul preached for 3 months in the synagogue. He lectured daily for a year and a half, or nearly, in fact, 2 years in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. In Rome, Paul hired a house, and in that house he received the Jewish leaders, and he talked to them from morning till evening. And then he spent a whole year with them, welcoming all who came to him, preaching the kingdom of God, teaching them about the Lord Jesus Christ quite openly and unhindered. That was how they got the gospel out. And there are a number of words that are used to describe what it is to share the gospel, as we see the church doing in our text this evening. The word to testify, the word to proclaim or to preach the gospel or to herald the gospel or to teach the gospel or to argue the gospel. The Jewish leaders complained about the early church. They said to the early apostles, you have filled Jerusalem with this teaching. You've filled the place with this teaching. Evangelism involves what John Stott, I think it was, once called urgent exhortation and patient explanation. Evangelism is not just inviting people to Jesus. Some of you teach Sunday school. Some of you may teach children in Sunday school in this church. If you do, that is not the place to be inviting children to Jesus. Number one, because they're covenant children. Number two, that's not why they're in Sunday school. You need to put stuff in so that they know what they're responding to. You need to give them teaching. That's why throughout the book of Acts, gospel work involves, let me give you a list of words that are used, to reason, to dispute, to argue, to convince, to confound, to prove, to confute powerfully. The business of these early Christian leaders was to persuade their hearers of the truth of the gospel, and the result they looked for was the obedience of faith. So the goal of evangelism then was to reason, dispute, testify, convince, confound, prove, persuade. And that's a process. That's a process. And what were their main themes? Well, of course, with our New Testament perspective, we would want to affirm what this bride has done here, and that is that her beloved is incomprehensible at one level. He is invisible to us. We have not yet seen him. She hasn't seen him because she can describe him. She knows what he's like because she's been taught about him, just as we have been taught about him. He's the eternal Son of God. He's the historic Jesus, this man attested by God with mighty works and wonders and signs which God did in your midst, Peter says to these people. He's the crucified man who by wicked hands, through ignorance, was delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. You took him, Herod and Pontius Pilate and the Gentiles, did what God predestined would be done. You hung him on a tree. The curse of God came down upon him. The eternal Son, the historic Jesus, the crucified man, the risen Lord. God vindicated him. You crucified him, you killed him, but God has made him both Lord, that is God, and Christ. You delivered him up, you denied him, but God glorified him. And he's at God's right hand. He's a leader and a savior. He's the Lord of all. He is on David's throne. That makes him an effective savior. His given name, Jesus, that is Jehovah, saves, foreshadows his powerful, mystical name, which is the sum total of all that he is and has done. He is Jehovah who saves. He is the Lord God of Israel who saves. And by his name, people are saved. He's the coming judge. Heaven has received him, but he will return. He'll return as judge. God has ordained him to be the judge of the living and the dead. And make no bones about it, we say to people, the day is set, the judgment is fixed, the judge is appointed, and it's the next item on the agenda of heaven. And he's the promised Messiah. He is the Christ, the Messiah, foretold by Moses. Moses, you remember, and I don't want you to worry, but I can't see what the time is on the clock. Sorry. Moses, you'll remember, promises in Deuteronomy, or it is promised, that there will come a prophet like Moses who will see God face to face. Now, Moses didn't see God face to face. Remember when he wanted to see the glory of God in Exodus 34? God said, "You can't see me and live, but you'll see the afterburner. I'm going to pass by and you can see the afterburner of my glory." But this prophet that's promised will see God face to face. John chapter 1. The law came from Moses. Grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Nobody can see God face to face. The only one, the Son, the God who is in the bosom of the Father, he has made him known. Jesus saw God face to face because he was the Son of God. He was eternally with God. John tells you right at the very beginning, he was face to face with God from all eternity, and he is God. Christ is the one foretold by Moses. In him, the promise to Abraham is fulfilled, that all the nations, the families of the earth will be blessed through him. In him, the new age has arrived, those days that all the prophets talked about. And for this reason, Paul and the apostles expounded Jesus from the law and the prophets. This Jesus, whom I proclaim to you, is the Messiah. And if you run through the New Testament, you find how Scripture foretells the necessity of his sufferings and his resurrection. The stone the builder rejected, the king from David's line, the one who sits at God's right hand, the one who gives the Spirit, as for Joel said, the one who gives forgiveness to all who believe, the one who is opposed by rulers, the one who is rejected by his own people. Nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would come to pass has come to pass in Jesus. This is my beloved. I am my beloved's, and he is mine. This is our testimony. This is the church's confession. This is what we believe. So maybe you're here tonight and you're asking the question, where has your beloved gone? Well, he's not gone anywhere. He's here. By the Holy Spirit, he's here. And you're here. And here's our confession to you. Our beloved is ours. We're his. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you would bless the exposition of your word and its application to our hearts tonight by the Holy Spirit. We pray that you would indeed cause this one whom we love, our beloved, who is your beloved Son, to fill our minds and hearts and to inspire our longings for glory when we will see him face to face. We pray in his strong name. Amen.
Thank you.
Forgive me that I was singing the original while you were singing the modified version. But it's a great hymn. When I was a little boy growing up and we sang that hymn, I used to think, it's morning in America. Receive the Lord's benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.